when it's come to the demise of the militant Islamist militant leader. Among them is why does it matter so much if Shekau is dead and alive? And two, will his death actually weaken Boko Haram or even cause the demise of a terror group? And what lesson can be drawn from other cases in which leaders of non-state armed group in Africa have been killed or incapacitated? And that those questions are going to be answered through a number of headlines. One is Who is Shekau? Where we explore the context and the factors of his rise as Boko Haram leader. Two, we look at the transformation of Boko Haram, if necessary, under his leadership. Three, dead or alive, why does it matter? We'll try to answer that question. And finally, I will look at the current status of Boko Haram as well as the way forwards in continuing the fight against Boko Haram and terrorist organizations in Nigeria and in the West African region. Who is Shekau? Is one of the questions that many ask, and we're not sure if we have the right answer because the personality of Shekau is as elusive as of the organization that he's leading, Boko Haram itself. But the information gathered here and there pointed that he's a Nigerian citizen, should be around 45 years old, who is seen as Islamic scholar. He attended a Islamic school in Yobe or in Borno, and believe in the monotheism, which is the oneness of God, a view that he tried to impose on his followers. He was the deputy to Yusuf Mohammed Yusuf, who was the first leader of Boko Haram. And we need really to understand that Yusuf emerged as a charismatic leader of Boko Haram, mobilized quite significant number of followers before he was killed in July 20, 2009. We need to take into consideration a number of factors that contributed to the emergence of Shekau as a leader. First of all, as I spoke about it earlier, the death of Yusuf in the police custody in 2009 was a key. And Boko Haram was looking for another leader, and then that facilitated the emergence of Shekau, even if he was contested initially and by some members of the organization. The two, we also have to take into consideration the political confusion prevailing at that moment around the succession of Yar'Adua and the transition in Nigeria. Certainly the discussion about the rotation between the North and South, about who is entitled to take the country forward. Thirdly, we also need to mention the ineffective response developed by the previous administration, particularly under Jonathan Goodluck, which provides almost the platform for Boko Haram to extend its reign of terror across the northern parts of Nigeria. And finally, the porosity of borders and the passivity of neighboring countries, it could also be cited as a very important contributing factors in the emergence of the organization the way we know it today. When it comes to the transformation of Boko Haram, I just want us to take a pause and look at the key signposts on the radicalization trajectory of Boko Haram. I think there are many reports that says initially Mohammed Yusuf was not as radical and violent as Boko Haram appears to today. Yet, the organization draws inspiration from the Mittelstein ideology, which generally rely more on popular riots, hit and run to draw attention on social ills that are affecting them and for which the organization has been created initially. Look, Shekau inherited Boko Haram from that standpoint and led it into extreme violence, developing it into a very radical organization today. with a very sophisticated propaganda machinery, strong network across the region, and considerable resources in terms of money, but also in terms of weapons, most of which come from the region, but also from abroad. Particularly, southern Libya has been the open market for acquisition of our weapons of the organization. And then, Boko Haram has become under Shekau, that powerful, radical entity capable of seizing and controlling territories, operating rockets, propelled grenades, RPGs, taking hostages, and even challenging the armies of Nigeria and other states in the region. Some believe that his rise to the leadership of the organization has produced one of the most brutal and deadly forms of terror ever witnessed in Africa, and his radicalism and indiscriminate attack on civilians had caused even the loss of sympathy and weakened Boko Haram's initial support base. We'll come back to develop that later during the Q&A session. Now, dead or alive, why does it matter? Few points. The Nigerian government and the regional allies will really welcome the demise, incapacitation of Shekau. I think news about his death could deal a blow to the morale for the militant group and give armed forces and the stakeholders fighting Boko Haram a confidence boost. But it may not diminish Boko Haram's effectiveness as terror group, for example. And we've seen that the kind of low-key treatment of the news and the kind of skepticism that welcomed the news. And that skepticism can be explained by a number of reasons that we're trying to put forward here. The first one is that in his announcement, Idris Deby failed to specify who had killed Shekau and how the leadership actually came about. I think that question has not been answered. Secondly, the long absence of what has become Shekau's regular video appearances, which full speculation that he was dead may be linked to the group's pledge of allegiance to the Islamic State in March. And we believe that in doing so, Shekau sought to yield the leadership and control of Boko Haram to the global terrorist network. Thirdly, the Nigerian government and the military leadership also would like to avoid repeating past embarrassments by rushing into pronouncements on his death. We have seen that many times the military hierarchy had made announcements about his death, only to see him resurrected a few days later. And that doesn't really show coherence and the professionalism in the military establishment. And finally, it is not certain that Shekau's death or change in Boko Haram leadership will mean the end of violence unleashed by Boko Haram. We have seen in Africa, across the continent, empirically, that removing leaders from armed groups can probably weaken them, but it can also lead to the proliferation of independent units that are even more dangerous than the main body. Shekau's death could probably also trigger a feeling of revenge that unites Boko Haram members, as happened with Al-Qaeda with the demise of Osama bin Laden. And in that case, we cannot exclude the fact that Western interests in Nigeria, Cameroon, Niger, and the neighboring countries become targets to his affiliated. And there are various examples to illustrate that. We have seen that the killing of Osama bin Laden has not even put an end to the existence of Al-Qaeda. And you can see with Al-Shabaab in Somalia and other organizations, terror organizations on the continent. Nigeria also has that experience. I think in 2009, when Yusuf was killed, many people believe that it's a giant step, it's a vigorous response developed against Boko Haram. But has he put an end to Boko Haram? No. In fact, we've seen a more robust and more deadly organization emerging from the arches. So what is the current status of Boko Haram with all these controversies around the life and the death of Abubakar Shekau? The organization truly remain extremely violent and active. Whether he's there or not, the organization remain active. But we also realize that since February, the tide has begun to turn. The sect has been defeated in some areas. Territories previously under its occupation has been recuperated, and the group has been dispersed and is now largely confined to the Zambisa forest, where they plan other sporadic operations today. It can be a small victory to the forces fighting Boko Haram. We have also seen that the group has now resorted to attack soft targets, going to the market, going to the mosque, responding to the call from al-Baghdadi to go to mosque and inflict pain to people, rather than engaging in a direct confrontation with a military establishment. Now, looking forward, we would like to say that the success of Nigerian President Muhammad Buhari's campaign against Boko Haram will be the key indicator as of his performance as he approaches 100 days in office today, because that was one of the major promises that he made to Nigeria, that he will defeat Boko Haram in 3 months, 90 days to be exact. So he has been there, but you will see on the contrary that whatever is happening coming from Boko Haram, you look at it for the past few months, most of the casualties continue a way of maybe compromising or even challenging the president and in his claim to be able to defeat Boko Haram in such a time frame. But a number of initiatives have been taken. I think we spoke about it previously, and it's necessary to maybe come back to refresh the mind. We've seen that the president has relocated the army headquarters to Maiduguri to take the fight to Boko Haram itself. Operated some key changes within the military hierarchy and instructed security forces to really put an end to the existence of Boko Haram in 3 months now. So he reinstated that promise and gave instruction to the army to do that even 90 days. We believe this is a very ambitious time frame, given the context and the condition in which Nigerian armed forces find themselves today. They need reorganizations, you need equipment, you need a number of things to take place. But we can also read in this the resolve of Nigerian authorities to really attack and end the reign of terror led by Boko Haram. In addition to that, we also see that regional effort to set the multinational joint task force of 8,700 troops from Nigeria, Chad, Cameroon, Niger, and Benin present an opportunity for an effective offensive against Boko Haram. I think those who unleash violence only understand the language of violence. It's one aspect of the strategy. Now you have a coordination, you have a coherence, you have an army dedicated to fight Boko Haram, to take the war to them, to respond to the attacks, to protect civilians and the populations. The Joint Task Force is headquartered in Jamina and is placed under the leadership of Nigeria. And in the long run, it will be supervised or under the control of the African Union, which shows the continental dimension of the fight against terrorism in Nigeria. This measure is welcome, but I think other measures are also needed to pursue. We always talk about the fact that the military response alone will not defeat the terrorists. And in terms of the military response, you also need to draw inspiration from what is called asymmetric warfare, because it cannot be the conventional kind of military engagement with the forces as you receive our terror organization. So definitely achieving or succeeding in defeating Boko Haram will require a coherent and comprehensive approach by all stakeholders and security agencies, which includes better laws and intelligence, well-equipped and trained armed forces, and unwavering political commitment. And that has been missing for many years in Nigeria. It seems to me that those ingredients are in place now. We also thought that now border control needs to be more effective. Because if I can kidnap from Cameroon and take it to Nigeria, or from Yobe and take it to Lake Chad, it's very problematic. So countries understand their interest in beefing up their border control. But more importantly, we believe that Boko Haram is getting funding from somewhere and a weapon from somewhere. Efforts should be increased to stop the flow of those resources to the organizations. I know it's a challenging operation in West Africa where weapons come from anywhere, borders are porous, and everyone, including members of the government, are involved in trafficking. But with the determination that the government is trying to display, probably something can be done in that regard. So to conclude, I think a multi-pronged approach is needed to fight Boko Haram, and Nigeria need to display a strong leadership in that regard if they want to give a chance, or if Buhari want to give a chance to the success of his mandate. So I will leave it there.